Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to this service of worship at Duke University Chapel. It's a great joy to have our students returning here today with us, and we are glad you are here. Whether you are here for the first time or whether you've returned after a summer away, we pray this is a place where you experience God's presence and where you know God's grace. Duke Chapel embodies the university's motto of Eruditio et Religio, bridging faith and learning. We hope that you will join us throughout this year here, finding a way to explore your faith. In your bulletin, you will find many opportunities for you to do this, and we trust that you will put this by your nightstand and read it every evening just to commit it to memory so you can know how easy it is to be part of the chapel's life. One of the things that you will see in this bulletin is the opportunity to audition for the beautiful chapel choir you just heard. These are auditions for students and for community members, but you can ask any of the students who've been in these auditions and they will tell you this is not something to be afraid of. And if you would like to talk with one of them, then you should stay after for the lunch that we are providing today for university students. Following worship, right out on the chapel lawn, you can stay with us, eat lunch. The chapel choir members who are students will still be in their robes, and so you can chat with them about their experience here. On this Sunday every year, we like to invite you all to chat with one another briefly as we begin our worship service. And so in about 30 seconds, I'm going to have you all stand up and turn to your neighbor and ask these two questions. Where are you from and what brought you here? And following our time of conversation, we will continue in worship through singing. So let's stand now and ask those questions. We've come singing praises this morning, and what a joyful thing it is. But we do so acknowledging the brokenness and the sickness of the world in which we live, and the ways that our sins and our failures have contributed to this. And so, as we gather, we come confessing our sins before God and each other, trusting in God's mercy for forgiveness and God's grace for our restoration. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As those who have been forgiven by God's grace, let us share words and signs of Christ's peace with one another.
Please join me for the prayer in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus taught his disciples to be persistent in prayer, give us patience and courage to hear what you say to us today, and never to lose hope, but always to bring our prayers before you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson today is from Exodus, the first and second chapters. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him for 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because, she said, "I drew him out of the water." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson today is from Romans, the 12th chapter. Dean Powery will be preaching from this text. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and what is acceptable and what is perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, and the compassionate in cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Matthew, the 15th chapter. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
seated. Let us pray. On this orientation Sunday, as we welcome new students and reorient ourselves as a chapel community, we acknowledge how good it is and lovely it is to be in your dwelling place. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. And everyone said, Amen. When I surveyed the lectionary readings and decided to preach on the Romans pericope, I sent a mental text message to myself, OMG, PPOP. Oh my God, Powry preach on Paul? Romans, if you don't know, is Paul's most theologically argumentative epistle, and preaching on Paul can be tricky business. But I want to thank Apostle Paul this morning for helping me remember one of my favorite preachers. She's a woman, and she is actually an unchurched preacher. No letters behind her name for seminary degrees, no degrees, actually, not even a GED. And though she doesn't have any school degrees, somehow she seems to possess a PhD in wisdom and love. There's one particular sermon of hers that is, to use the words of Nat King Cole, that's unforgettable. Her name is Baby Suggs Holy, a woman preacher in Toni Morrison's novel, Beloved. This novel is a fictional narrative account of a former slave's memories of post-Civil War Ohio. Baby Suggs Holy, despite having busted her legs, back, head, eyes, hands, kidneys, womb, and tongue through the furnace of slavery, preaches about the corporeal body to a corporate body in what was known as the clearing in the woods. Morrison writes that she preaches from her heart, and this is some of what she proclaimed. In this here place, we flesh, flesh that weeps, laughs, flesh that dances on bare feet in grass, love it. Yonder they do not love your flesh. They don't love your eyes, no more do they love the skin on your back. And oh my people, they do not love your hands. Those they only use, tie, bind, chop off, and leave empty. Love your hands, raise them up and kiss them. You got to love it. And no, they ain't in love with your mouth. This is flesh I'm talking about here, flesh that needs to be loved. Feet that need to rest and to dance, backs that need support, shoulders that need arms, strong arms, I'm telling you. And oh, my people out yonder, hear me. They do not love your neck unnoosed and straight. So love your neck. Put a hand on it, grace it, stroke it, and hold it up. And all your inside parts, you got to love them. The dark, dark liver, love it, and the beat and beating heart, love that too, more than eyes or feet, more than lungs that have yet to draw free air, more than your life-holding womb and your life-giving parts. Hear me now. Love your heart, for this is the prize. Saying no more, Morrison continues, she stood up then and danced with her twisted hip the rest of what her heart had to say, while others opened their mouths and gave her the music. Long notes held until the four-part harmony
was perfect enough for their deeply loved flesh. What a sermon. Baby Suggs Holy not only urges the hearers to love their flesh because out yonder they don't love it, but she uses her body, particularly her twisted hip, as the climax of her heartfelt sermon while the community brings it to a close with chapel choir-like music. Baby Suggs Holy talks about the body, uses her body to preach a word of hope to those whose bodies had been mistreated. Her explicit exhortation to love the flesh means to love the body. And when she says love your heart, she's implying to love your whole self. This somatic sermonic scene has been called a liturgy of spirit, which should be no surprise since the Apostle Paul reminds us that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. In other words, Baby Suggs encourages us to love your head and shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. And why shouldn't we? We can't leave our bodies at the narthex door when we come to worship. We walk in, we process in, we stand, we sit, we sing, we pass the peace. Some make the sign of the cross, others bow before the cross. Some even, if you can't believe this, even sleep during sermons. Many years ago, a 9-year-old boy gave me a memorable departing gift of a picture he called Luke Preaching to Sleeping People. And in that picture, he showed everyone in the congregation sleeping on cots while I preached. Our bodies worship, and our bodies are at worship. We couldn't worship without them because our bodies are liturgical texts. If we could escape our bodies, we would be leaving out a critical part of our Christian life. And why wouldn't we love our bodies anyway? God did. The incarnation of God in Jesus Christ in human form reveals how God embraces the body and implicitly affirms human bodies as significant for the spiritual life. God loved the world so much that he became a human body so that there would be no bodies. At the heart of the Christian faith is a broken body hanging helplessly on a cross, a body offered as a sacrifice. A bodily performance of cruciform love, affirming the importance of bodies for the life of faith, and the body as an epistemic site of God's presence and glory. Yet we continue to struggle in the church and in the academy to remain whole selves. We won't say, check your brain at the door of the church. But we may think it's okay to check our bodies at the door, as if worship is only about mental ascent, as if a university education is only about our neck up. Through the combination of Neoplatonic philosophy and the privileging of an Enlightenment mentality a la Descartes, I think, therefore I am. The mind predominates the body historically. Therefore, the goal has become to escape bodily reality as a pathway to a deeper spirituality. In this perspective, the body is viewed as suspicious, threatening, and dangerous, if not controlled, thus irrelevant for the Christian life. But the body is inescapable. And thinking that bodies are unimportant for faith and faithful discipleship opens the door for the exploitation of bodies. When a body, some body, is deemed insignificant, it can be treated in any way because it is viewed as disconnected from the spiritual life. This is what led to the brutal context of slavery in Beloved and its associated corporeal terrorism. When bodies don't matter, we can torture them and shoot them and behead them and objectify them and brand them and hang them and make fun of them and ignore them and abuse them, including little innocent bodies. A disembodied faith is disengaged from everybody. To be anti-body is to be anti-human and anti-God, because God became a human body to redeem and heal bodies and claim them as vital for the spiritual life. The incarnation of Jesus is proof of the importance of the body as a means of grace and knowledge. Our bodies have been graced with the presence of God as humans created in the image of God. But every time we hurt the body intentionally, we destroy the beautiful image of God found in the collective body, and we reveal a distorted and immature spirituality. Any move toward the destruction of a body is a gesture in the direction of the destruction of God. Because to embrace a body is to embrace an enfleshed God and to affirm that we encounter God not by leaving the material world, but by immersing ourselves more deeply into it. By embracing our bodies, we become more fully human. By embracing our bodies and presenting them as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, we engage in what Paul calls spiritual or rational worship. Paul affirms the body as a locus of doxology and says elsewhere, glorify God in your body. He places the body front and center in the Christian life. He's not body shy. He teaches that a bodily sacrifice is spiritual or rational. That means the spiritual includes our bodies. Spirituality implies, encompasses materiality. To be spiritual means to be embodied. What you do with your body and to someone else's body is integral to your faith. And even if we use the translation rational worship instead of spiritual, Paul maintains his integrative vision, because that would suggest that reasonable worship is embodied and that he's calling for what author Mark Johnson calls the body in the mind. Paul would not allow us to live disintegrated lives, and so he foregrounds the human body as critical for a Christian response to God's mercy. Bodies matter for Paul, because if one wants to become more spiritual, one should become more embodied as a human and person of faith, not more disembodied. The Christian faith is a material one, not just a virtual hashtag one on Twitter. It takes place in and through bodies. And for Paul, this is not just the corporeal body, but a corporate body of a community. His bodily vision includes other bodies, not just the individual one. To be a Christian is to have a body and be a part of a body, because the Christian life should not be lived alone in solitary confinement. None of us here today have arrived here by our own resources. Somebody prayed for you, and someone supported you and encouraged you and cheered you on, gave you an opportunity, taught you how to read and write and think and explore. You are here because of the corporate body. And Paul uses that ancient metaphor of body, which is a social metaphor, to imply unity. He says, "For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another." An aspect of being transformed by the renewing of our minds deals with our and other bodies, in that one should not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Because all in this community have gifts, though different, but each gift, each member, each body part is vital to the formation of a whole body. Every body matters, because everybody is a somebody in the kingdom of God. And in the kingdom of God, there are no nobodies. And this is actually a part of the transformation that has to occur in our minds if we are to move beyond all of the hate in our world, in Ferguson, Missouri, in Iraq, in Nigeria, on the eastern border of Ukraine and Russia. Conforming to the world means privileging the self over others and disregarding some bodies because of fear and selectively respecting other bodies. Yet we cannot be one body without every body part. Paul's vision will not allow us to slip into a type of spiritual solipsism. If his body metaphors was insufficient for calling us to community, Paul does something else. Notice, present your bodies as plural, and living sacrifice is singular. There are many bodies, but there's only one sacrifice. How we are together in our life together as a community signals whether our worship is holy and acceptable to God. Embodied community in Christ, in which the gifts of others are valued and each member uses one's gifts on behalf of the body as a whole. This is worship, says Luther Seminary professor Mary Hinkleshore. This is a sacrifice that is alive, holy, and acceptable to God. There can be no living sacrifice without each other and the inclusion of every member of the body. No individual body is too wide or too thin or too short or too tall or too dark or too light, because everybody is somebody. And not until everybody is deemed a somebody can we make the one sacrifice. Until we acknowledge our common humanity, our communal sacrifice will be incomplete because it won't be one. The sacrifice will be unacceptable and impossible if all bodies do not come together as one, and until all bodies are considered to be members of one another, a part of the same body. There can be no acceptable sacrifice until we truly believe that our destinies are tied together and we live in an inescapable web of mutuality and act in ways that embody this belief. Our worship as a community will only be acceptable to God when we are truly one. Because what is acceptable to God is the unity of the body. Without that, there is no spiritual worship or living sacrifice. Without that, there's no transformation, only evidence of conformation to the way it has always been. And it has to be clear to us by now that the way it has always been is not working in our world. The one singular sacrifice can only be holy when the body is holy, totally one. So this new academic year, will you present your bodies for the wholeness of the one body in Christ? Will you sacrifice so that the one sacrifice can be made? Will you give of yourselves for the greater good of the community? While embracing your own body, will you affirm everybody and recognize that grace has been extended to all to offer a holy and whole sacrifice to God? Everyone can't be a leg or a toe, or an exhorter or a leader, and thank God, everyone can't be a Tar Heel. Football season is coming. You can only, as an Emory professor taught, do you and be you. And we need you here this year. We need your gifted and graced bodies in order to be the one body in Christ and to offer the one sacrifice in order to truly worship God. So here in this place, love your body, despite what others might have told you in the past. Because you can't truly love anybody if you don't love yourself. Your eyes, your skin, your hands, your mouth, your feet, your back, your shoulders, and your arms, your neck, and your inside parts, your liver and lungs, your heart. Love your body, but don't forget to love the one body in Christ. Because it is only in connection with this one body that you will discover what it truly means to have communion with God. May we all make four-part harmony together this year. And let every body say, Amen.
As we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You may be seated. I am pleased to introduce my colleagues, Adam Hollowell, who is our Director of Student Ministry, and Joshua Lazard, who is our new C. Eric Lincoln Minister. They have a few words to say about student ministry opportunities.
Good morning. As Megan said, my name is Adam Hollowell. I'm the Director of Student Ministry, and this is Joshua Lazard, our brand new C. Eric Lincoln Minister for Student Engagement. On behalf of everyone who works in student ministry at Duke Chapel, let me say how delighted we are that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. The God who is at work here in Duke Chapel will move your body out into this campus, into this city, and into this world. If you look along the walls, you will see images of the many ways that God moves students in mind, body, and spirit through ministry in this place. We want to highlight a few of the programs this morning.
So first, after your hearts and spirits are filled from this service, we want to make sure that your stomachs are filled as well. First, we're having a free lunch today after worship for all students immediately out of the back doors of the chapel to the left. This will give you a chance to give Dr. Powery back some feedback on his sermon and to find more about the chapel staff and to find more about student life here at the chapel. We have some burritos from Durham's Cosmic Cantina, and several members of the congregation here at Duke Chapel have also made some homemade cookies to welcome you to your new home.
The second thing you can do is to find one of these white cards in your bulletin. If you fill this out, you can let us know a little bit more about yourself. You'll also notice at the bottom of the card that there are a variety of boxes you can check to tell us what you might be interested in joining here at Duke Chapel. We have students who sing in the chapel choir, in United in Praise Gospel Choir, students who participate in worship, in Serve Communion. We have students who take mission trips to Costa Rica and courses in public policy. We have interfaith programming, small groups. The list is very long. If any of these spark your interest, please fill out the card and drop it in the offering plate when it is passed later in the service.
Finally, we'd love to be a part of your life here at Duke. We are made up of one body and many members. We work with some truly beautiful colleagues: Bruce, Megan, Christy, Beth, Luke. We are all here to serve you. If you need somebody to talk with you, to listen to you, to pray with you, even just somebody to have a chat with, we hope that you will join this body during your time here so that we can partner in your journey through the transforming of your mind. We pray that you will find God in this place and that we look forward to seeing you after service at lunch. Amen.
Thank you both. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Transforming God, who has fearfully and wonderfully made each of us, help us to become your body on this campus and in this community. Open our eyes to discover the unique gifts you've given each of us. Open our ears to learn from each other, even in rage, disagreement, and lament. Ignite in us a desire for the good, even when the wider good requires personal sacrifice. Loving God, we bring before you our bodies. Make your grace known to us when our relationship to our own bodies is filled with sadness or shame. Draw near to us when our bodies do not reveal your wonder, but our weakness. Overshadow us with the knowledge that nothing we can do in body or in spirit can separate us from your overwhelming love for us. Lord, in your mercy. Life-giving God, your servant Moses was born into a context of oppression and fear. We name before you the many places in our world whose people are pressed down and afraid today. Breathe your peace over the people of Ferguson, Syria, and Iraq. Hold close to your heart all who wait in hope that the justice of your world would invade and transform the justice of ours. Cherish all who are weary of waiting. Look with mercy on communities besieged by anger and instability and acrimony, and transform them into places of promise and new growth and harmony. Draw near to the people of San Francisco area this morning after this morning's earthquake. Lord, in your mercy. Tender God, you adore us like a parent, yet make yourself as vulnerable to us as a child. This morning we lift to your care the new students from various parts of our world who will call Duke home. We pray that this becomes a place of rich friendships, new insights, and much laughter. Hold close to your heart all those for whom this transition feels disorienting, lonely, or overwhelming. Give comfort to all families who face the beginning of the college year with trepidation. Bless those who find it bewildering to let go or feel bereft of companionship or purpose when a bedroom and a place at the table are suddenly empty. Lord, in your mercy. Take our lives and let them be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Lord, you know us completely and love us still. Reveal your heart to us, that we might come to find ourselves in it and discover the joy of life shared with you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning's offering will go to human service organizations within Durham. God has given us so much. Let us offer our gifts back to God.
all creation. You made every body and everything and called it good. We celebrate the many and varied gifts that you bestow on your people, and we pray that being transformed by the renewing of our minds, we may all become a living sacrifice that is good and acceptable. Life-giving God, take the gifts offered here today and use them in the service of those who are in need in our community. Strengthen social service agencies that feed those who are hungry, clothe those who are naked, and provide shelter to those who are homeless. God of wisdom, we thank you for the gift of understanding that your people may discern your way and live by your will. We lift up in thanksgiving students and staff who are new to the Duke campus, as well as those who are returning. And we pray that all may find here a faithful community of friends and a union of eruditio and religio. We also remember today other institutions of higher education, and we rejoice in the pursuit of knowledge in every age. Shine the light of your wisdom into our hearts, O God, and open our minds to the knowledge of your word, that in all things we may think and act according to your good will. And hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, may the Lord who made you and keeps you also send you forth, that together we may be a living sacrifice that glorifies God. And may God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with you and guide you today and evermore. Amen.